हेलो, दिस इज अरविंद कुमार, पीजीटी बायोलॉजी फ्रॉम सुदिति ग्लोबल एकेडमी. वेलकम टू स्टूडेंट्स इन ऑनलाइन क्लासेस. लेट अस स्टार्ट विद द बायोलॉजी विद फर्स्ट चैप्टर, रिप्रोडक्शन इन ऑर्गेनिज्म. सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वी हैव टू नो द डेफिनेशन ऑफ रिप्रोडक्शन. रिप्रोडक्शन इज अ बायोलॉजिकल प्रोसेस इन विच द प्री एग्जिस्टिंग ऑर्गेनिज्म प्रोड्यूसेस द न्यू वन which are similar to their parents. The first heading is lifespan. Lifespan is the time period between the birth to the natural death. So each and every organism have a fixed life. Lifespan is generally calculated as average life. Like you know that the male fly have only one day lifespan. Means it only survive for one day. Likewise, the crow for 15 years and the parrot for 140 years. So very well know that the average life is fixed for each and every organism. Here the size of organism does not affect the lifespan. The crow and the parrot both have little bit similar size, but there is very big difference in lifespan. Here you see that the crow have only 15 years while the parrot have 140 years. So this is the difference between the lifespan. The size is not affect the lifespan of organism. Now come to know the types of reproduction and why it is necessary to reproduce by each and every organism, whether they are animals or plants. Reproduction is an essential process to produce the new one so that the life becomes continue on the earth. For the continuity of a species, each and every organism reproduce, but the method of reproduction is different in each and every organism. Like some of them involve only single parent to produce. You know very well that the rose plant can grow with the help of a single twig. Such type of reproductions are called asexual reproduction. While the other organism that involve the two parents for their production, they are called sexual reproduction. In asexual reproduction, the single parent is involved. There is no gamete formation, and hence no gamete formation, no need to fertilization. So without gamete formation and fertilization, the new organisms are produced. Such type of reproduction is called asexual reproduction. All the individuals produced after the asexual reproduction, they are called clones. So, student, here you have a question. What are clones? Suppose this question is asked to you. So you have a very good answer that all the individuals produced from the asexual reproduction, which are morphologically and genetically similar. All the individuals which are produced from asexual reproduction, they are genetically and morphologically similar, and they are called clones. So everybody got the answer. What is clones? All the individuals produced from the asexual reproduction, which are genetically and morphologically similar, they are called clones. So, differences between the sexual and asexual reproduction. In asexual reproduction, the clones are produced. While in sexual reproduction, little variations are comes. So the individual produced by sexual reproduction are not matched to each other. So we can conclude that variations are arises in sexual reproduction. While in case of asexual reproduction, the variations are not produced. Now come to the different method of reproduction while the asexual or the sexual. Different organisms apply the different methods of reproduction. Here we are going to discuss the different asexual methods applied by different organisms to produce the new eggs. So let us start with the types of asexual reproduction. Different type of asexual reproductions are involved in different organism, but we have to study from simple to the difficult. So most simplest is the binary fission. In which the parental body splits into two daughter cells by means two. So two equal daughter cells are produced from the parent cell. This is called binary fission. For example, in amoeba, bacteria, etc. You can see the diagram of amoeba in your NCERT book. There is a binary fission where the parent cell start splitting from mid to produce the two equal daughter cells. So you can see the diagram in your NCERT book, how the amoeba reproduced. Similarly, the bacteria can also divide within 20 minutes by the binary fission to produce the two equal daughter cells. So binary fission is the most simplest method applied by organism to reproduce. One more thing is that sometimes we say that the single organism cannot die, means they are immortal, because so there is one question, why the single cell organism are called immortal? Matlab single cell organism ki death nahi hoti hai. So you have a good answer that the single cell organism apply the binary fission, so the parental cell divides into two equal daughter cells and nothing is left behind for the death. This is the reason why the single cell organism never die. Okay, so after binary fission there is another method of fission which is called multiple fission. In multiple fission, the nucleus of the parental body divides into many nuclei and it produces the multiples of the daughter cells, not only two. For example, plasmodium. Plasmodium always divides by the multiple fission where it produces a large number of cells, your daughter cells. Next is the budding. Budding is another method of asexual reproduction which is commonly used by yeast, hydra or some sponges. In yeast, you see that the parental cell after maturity, there is an outgrowth in parent cell. Which if detached from parent body, grow into the complete individual. This is called bud. And when this bud detached from the parent body, it grow and form a complete individual. The same thing you can see in your NCERT book. There is a diagram for budding in yeast, and you can also see the budding in hydra. In case of hydra, you see that a little bud is outgrowth from their body. When it detaches from the body of the hydra, it grows into complete hydra. So this is the method of reproduction, where you see that there is no need of formation of gamete, no need of fertilization, and the new individuals are growing, are produced. So these are two methods we have discussed here, the binary fission and the budding. The third example is sponges. In sponges, you see that sponges are colonial animals. They multiply by budding during the favorable condition and form their colonies. So this is bud, which grows from the parent body, and in this way it produces the many sponges. So you see that the budding, the binary fission, and the multiple fission, all are the simple method of asexual reproduction. Now we have to discuss some more types of this asexual reproduction. Spore formation. In spore formation, the third is spore formation. Spore formation is also an asexual method of reproduction, which is commonly applied by lower plants like algae, fungi, bryophytes, ferns, or pteridophytes, etc. Here, the different type of spores are produced by the organism during the favorable or unfavorable condition. During the favorable condition, let us start with the algae. During the favorable condition, algae start producing the zoospores. See the diagram in your NCERT, there is a zoospore in Chlamydomonas. During favorable condition, the Chlamydomonas reproduce by the formation of zoospores. You have a diagram in your NCERT. So you see that zoospore formation is a method of asexual reproduction in algae. Here these are spores which have two flagella, and they help to swim in the water. Their body can move from one place to another place just like the animals, hence they are called zoo. Zoo means animals, spores. Okay? So zoospores produced by algae may are similar in their morphology. If they are similar in their morphology, they are called homogametic. If the zoospores are similar in their morphology, they are called homogametic. And if they are different in their morphology, they are called heterogametic. Let us come to describe the spore formation in fungi. You see that in fungi there is hyphae. Septate hyphae having the different cells, and some cells grows into sporangia like structure where the nucleus divides and produces the different nuclei. Later on, these nuclei surrounded by the cytoplasm, cell division takes place and each compartment differentiated into spherical spores. So, what is sporangia? Sporangia is a spore containing structure present in fungi. For example, rhizopus, bread mold. In bread mold, you see that there is a bulb-like structures, and these bulb-like structures are actually the sporangium. Each sporangium contains billions of the spores. When the wall of this sporangia ruptures and air blown, these spores blow and fall into different places where they grow and again produces the new hyphae. This is the method of reproducing by the fungi. Okay, so example is rhizopus. You also see that in the same page you see the diagram, Chlamydomonas producing the zoospore. Just beside the Chlamydomonas there is a Penicillium, also a fungi which have conidiophores like this, and the spores are produced openly, not endogenously. This method is called exogenous spore formation. Here the Penicillium produces exogenous spores and these spores are called conidia. Conidia. So in Penicillium, which is also called green mold, produces the exogenous spores, while the rhizopus produces endogenous, and many more fungi also produces the exogenous spores like Aspergillus and others, Fusarium, etc. So spore formation is method of asexual type. Now come to the fragmentation. After spore formation, come to the fragmentation. You already studied about the fragmentation. In fragmentation, the filamentous algae, the fragmentation is common in filamentous algae like Spirogyra. You see that in filamentous algae, if the filament of the algae breaks by any way into small pieces, then all the pieces, all the fragments develops into complete filament. This is the method of production of new individuals in filamentous algae. So the fourth one is called fragmentation. Example is Spirogyra, and you have already seen the diagram in class 10th NCERT where the different fragments develops into complete organism. After fragmentation, now come to the regeneration. Regeneration is a method of recovering the broken part of the body. But why it is considered as a method of reproduction? Because in platyhelminthes like the planaria, you see that there is a high power of regeneration. If the body breaks into small pieces, then each piece have to develop or regenerate into complete organism. That's why it can be considered as method of reproduction. So example is planaria. Now come to a new term, parthenogenesis. Parthenogenesis, this is a new term for all the students. You never have listened about this just this before this class. So see that parthenogenesis is another method where the gametes fusion does not take place, and the new individuals are produced without fertilization. Mention it. The process of development of new individuals without formation of or without fertilization. Listen once. The method of production of new individuals without fertilization is called parthenogenesis. Now the question arises, where does this parthenogenesis occurs? So this parthenogenesis occurs in honeybee, turkey birds, whip-tailed lizards, many rotifers, etc. So this is the method where the gamete formation takes place, but the fusion of gametes doesn't take place, and the female gamete generally directly develops into the new individuals. Examples are honeybee, turkey birds, whip-tailed lizards. Many times the CBSE board has asked the question, while the whip-tailed lizard always produces females and females, so you see that there is no fertilization and the individuals directly develop from the egg. So might be the due to the parthenogenesis, the females are all produced in generation after generation. So these are the examples of parthenogenesis. So this is all about the asexual reproduction. We have discussed about asexual reproduction in lower plants, different animals, but still we have not discussed about the plants. So the asexual reproduction in plants, which can better say that the vegetative reproduction in plants. Why it is vegetative? The asexual reproduction in plants can be called as vegetative reproduction in plants. But the question is that why it is vegetative? So first of all, we have to know the parts of the plant. Each plant have two parts. Two parts means vegetative part and reproductive part. The vegetative part includes the root, stem and leaves, while the reproductive part includes the flower. So if we produce the new plants by using their root, stem or leaves in the plants, we can say that this is a vegetative reproduction. Okay, so root, stem and leaves, these are the parts of the plant which are considered under the vegetative part. Here the new individuals are produced by using these parts, either root or stem or leaves. Can you mention any example of the plants which grows through the roots? Anyone? Okay. So just write down this one, that Dalbergia means sisu. Guava and the sweet potato. These are the plants which can grow through the roots. Guava, sweet potato and Dalbergia. These plants can grow through the roots. You see the surrounding of the guava plant. If one plant has been grown in our place, you see that the new plants are arises just behind or just beside of these plants. Likewise, in Dalbergia plant, you see that if there is single Dalbergia plant, Sisu plant, in any place, many more plants can develop naturally. But actual thing is that, yeah, logic behind this, the roots develops new plants from the parent plant. So we have completed up to the root. The new plants which are produced from the roots, our examples are guava, sweet potato and Dalbergia, matlab sisal. Okay, so the different plants which are produced from the stem, they are also vegetatively propagated, like sugarcane, rose. You see in your daily life, the sugarcane, the rose and the potato, these plants are always grown through the help of stem. You see that then in sugarcane, the long stem is cutted into small pieces, and these pieces are grown into the soil. After few days, these pieces arises the new plants from their buds. So if we have to know that what is present in the stem that gives rise this new plants, for this we have observed the stem of sugarcane. There is a nodes and internodes, and each node have a small bud. With the help of this bud, the new plants are grown. One side it gives rise the roots, while the other side it gives rise the stem. Okay, so nodes and internodes are which are present in the stem, they have buds, and these buds help in grow, help to grow the new plants. The last one is the leaves. In class 10th you have see the diagram of the bryophyllum. Bryophyllum which have leaf notch, and each notch have a bud. These are notches that have buds likewise. After maturity of these leaves, these buds grown into the new plants, and if they fall into the soil, the root merge into the soil and the new plant develops. So these are the different parts of the plant that grow the new plants. Without production of any gametes or fusion of any gamete, one thing that has escaped from the topic is gemmule formation in sponges. So different parts of the plant which are used in propagating the new plants, they are called vegetative propagules. So one question can be asked to you, what is vegetative propagule? You have to give a short answer that the part of the plant which is used to propagate the new plant is called vegetative propagules. The different plant use the different parts to propagate the new plants. For example, potato, tuber, agave, bulbil, you can see these diagrams in your NCERT book, the bulbil, the tuber, the rhizome. ginger, turmeric. In ginger and turmeric, even in banana, okay, you see the rhizome, which has the nodes and internodes, and each node have different buds that can grow into new plants. Offset runners, suckers, these are also considered as a vegetative propagules. In water hyacinth, you see the stem, which is called offset. If we break its stem into small piece and thrown into any water body, it can grow into complete plant. So it acts as a vegetative propagule. In loop grass, you see the runner, the stem of the grass, which if cut into small pieces and these pieces can thrown into soil, they grow into new grass. So all these parts of plant that help to propagate the new plants, they all act as vegetative propagules. In mint and chrysanthemum, there is a suckers which run inside the soil, or substrata of the soil. So here we have mentioned different kind of vegetative propagules. Now one question our NCERT asked, that all the plants which are propagated through this method can be called as clone or can be considered as clone. You can see the same question in your NCERT. So the right answer is that yes, we can consider them as clone because they all are morphologically and genetically similar. Okay. So this is all about the asexual reproduction. One thing that remain is gemmule formation in sponges. Earlier we have discussed about the spore formation, where we discuss about the Rhizopus, Penicillium, and this all. In the same line, during unfavorable condition, sponges use another method to protect themselves. During unfavorable condition, some archaeocyte cells of the sponges are enclosed in a mucus wall, like this. In your NCERT, there is a diagram of gemmule formation in sponges. So you can see the same diagram in your NCERT. There is a lot of cells. These cells are called archaeocyte cells, which are covered by mucilaginous sheath. Okay. Now you see the spicules. There is a spine-like structures. These are called spicules. That may be calcareous or siliceous. If they are made up of silica, they are called siliceous. And if they are made up of calcium carbonate, they are called calcareous. See the structure in your NCERT. So these cells are protected from a tough covering for a time period. Until the favorable condition does not return, these cells are safe, and on returning the favorable condition, the same cells grow into new individual. Okay? So this is all about the asexual reproduction.